This video is controversial. . 2024 has begun. This is the 10th year of this platform's existence, and 900 videos released, an introspective examination and self-assessment of content typology and reception outcome of my own work is, I believe, paramount. Most importantly, I ask myself, what is the message that I am sharing with the world? For this year's content, the usual baseline of historical videos, like these, is still going to be the core of my production. I will also continue ongoing series, such as these. But what about these types of videos? Am I going to drop the controversial stuff once and for all? The offensive content, the content that gets me waves of hate in that ungodly wasteland called Reddit. This question is a great opportunity for an empirical discussion on modern logic in argumentation discourse, to understand why controversy arises and to encourage an open exchange of opposing thoughts. You see, to answer this with a yes or a no is inappropriate, because it would be a way to dignify a question that is based on a false assumption, the assumption being that these videos are in fact controversial in the first place. I argue they shouldn't be. So I'll ask a question of my own instead. Why are these videos deemed controversial? In fact, what is controversy? And I ask this not only as a general principle of psychology of the masses, but also specifically within the educational and entertainment cyberspace, in connection with the spheres of information and communication technology. Due to the spread of social media, and with the safety of internet anonymity, a certain frowning upon topics considered controversial has been bolstered. We got so used to the idea that certain specific keywords make content controversial that we have been effectively gaslit into accepting it as a base of discourse, even though we should be questioning the foundation of such a mental positioning. Furthermore, what is the cognitive significance which ignites a negative sentiment within any given discourse? Admittedly, a comprehensive data analysis alone won't cut it this time. Yet, I suppose humans do operate on foreseeable patterns, which is why history is so important to study. Accurate historical education gives us access to a species-level collective knowledge, yet there are clear forces at play that seek to manipulate historical truth for the benefit of the few at the expenses of the many, and then label all who disagree with them as controversial, or worse. So today I ask, why is it controversial to talk about topics that may enrich the knowledge of our past? Why is it controversial to question, when questioning is the very basis of learning? Why is it controversial to openly refute the systematic erasure and rewriting of established historical facts, specifically when not based on empirical evidence? Why is it controversial for me to talk about a topic when the very people who label my content controversial do the very same in reverse, clearly showing a double standard at play? And finally, why is it controversial to have a different opinion if that opinion is in fact based on facts? The moment children, students, citizens, humans feel afraid or ashamed of asking questions, pressured to hide their interests and beliefs, the moment the court of public opinion deems appropriate to judge people based on what may be rather than what is, we will be replacing innocent until proven guilty with innocent until proven offended. Hence, I'll rephrase. This isn't just a question. It's a fundamental exploration and reassessment of our core values as a society. Are our conclusions rational or emotive? Are intelligent interactions being replaced by heated contrasts instead? Are we more prone to label as conflict what would instead be more correctly defined as productive dialogue? In the wake of the digital era, due to the exponential increase of information data flow and social media range, the accuracy, neutrality, and quality of the presented content, together with purity of intent, are of prime importance in this day and age. An issue, topic, discussion, word becomes controversial due to the very specific patterns of societal shift in core values, which are then directly transferred within the digital discourse. Language, apart from being a tool for conveying thought, can be used as a means of manipulation. So, this is a form of extreme cognitive correction. Cognitive restructuring is a technique that has been successfully used to change the way people think. It is normally used for stress management, but it can be applied for a wide range of situations. So how do we guard from it? Well, a deep level of understanding and education when it comes to any given topic that is now considered to be controversial is a great way to prepare not only against possible mental manipulation techniques, but also to successfully guard from selective bias. But have we as individuals been primed to think in a specific way, particularly when it comes to what is deemed controversial as a society? Well, according to Benford's law of controversy, there is indeed a connection between the lack of confidence on a part of the disputant and the perception of a topic as controversial, particularly when an emotional reaction is ignited. In other words, just to give you an example, you're more likely to oppose a scientific position if you lack the basic knowledge and understanding and information about that specific topic, in order for any person to comprehend the position that they're opposing. And yet, if simply being informed was enough to avoid all forms of controversies, then the phenomenon of having two individuals being exposed to the same type of data and yet reaching to completely different conclusions would not occur. And yet it does. This may be understood and explained within the concept called bounded rationality. Namely, in human decision-making process, we have the tendency to satisfy rather than optimize. In our day-to-day, we tend to seek a decision that is good enough rather than finding the best or most optimal solution in every single given dilemma. This does work well, but is not apt for complex subjects and may lead to a psychological state called anchoring. To be impartial and to avoid calling everything controversial, even things that are not really supposed to be, we need to make sure that we form valid, coherent, and robust perceptions by reviewing and assessing all available data from all sorts of respectable sources, deciding to integrate or segregate data based on their merit alone. And yet, as evidenced by Google Engram, controversial, specifically what we as people consider controversial, rises. Note, however, how we don't seem to be that interested in what controversy is, but just seem to be labeling stuff controversial more and more as we stride across the centuries. Wikipedia itself has an entire section dedicated to a list of what are now considered controversial issues. A quick look will reveal much more about our current state of societal affairs and collective mind. Decision-making about complex subjects requires deep empirical studies and the least possible amount of selective bias. As for this platform and the relevance of these kind of topics, how strange is it for a channel dedicated to history to debunk inconsistent information? Is the statement, "this helmet is historically inaccurate in this specific setting," so different, so distant from the statement, "this ethnicity is incorrect and historically inaccurate in this specific setting"? My decision to begin tackling topics such as religion, sexuality, ethnicity on this very platform is not only based on the fact that these topics tend to get decent views, as I have been accused of, but it is also because I think it is in the very true nature of this platform, as a platform seeking for historical truth, to be not afraid to talk about topics, even if they may be sensitive. As long as your intentions are pure, you should not be afraid to discuss any topic. That's academia. In the true spirit of research, one shouldn't be afraid or ashamed of asking a specific question in the midst of his research, including, what did people in this ex-civilization look like? As much as, what did they sound like? How did they go to war? What weapons and armor did they use? How did they dress? What did they eat? Did they allow weddings between same-sex attracted people? All of this belongs to the same category, the study of ancient civilizations. I have always envisioned the Metatron channel as a channel about civilization, culture, language, and ancient military warfare. But most of all, I love asking questions and am passionate of finding the real answers. And the simple fact that some people may find those answers offensive if they don't line up with their preconceived ideas is not my problem. So I ask again, why is asking were the ancient Romans black a controversial question? Sure, if I was pushing an actual racist viewpoint, of course. But the question in itself isn't racist. The question is based on curiosity. How dare they assume with no proof, no evidence, that the mere presence of the question makes our intentions automatically racist? Moreover, even though such questions would already be legitimate in a vacuum, it is a fact that the modern media is constantly trying to present incorrect historical information as true. Therefore, the topics are more than apt. You would think that exposure to empirical facts would be sufficient to resolve a debate, but from what we can see through the research done in computer simulations of cultural communities, whenever there are members of an isolated subgroup, a certain level of confidence is generated whether this community has access to ground truth or not. Although, of course, if unhindered access to real truth is within the realm of possibilities of said subgroup, the before-mentioned confidence would not be misplaced. Therefore, be careful who you follow. Always ask, what are their motives? Research of truth or pushing a specific agenda at all costs? If the answer is the latter, walk away. My goal is to observe, comprehend, report. Therefore, at the beginning of 2024, I recommit. I will absolutely continue down this path because I tell it how it is. I work in the defense of historical truth, and over these years, I have encountered all sorts of resistance in my path, including unfounded accusations of political bias, the issue of polarization, and in general a certain disdain by some individuals for my supposed choice of moving away from a historical channel changing into a politically motivated grifting content production. Ludicrous. However, it's important to also underline the fact that there is sometimes a certain area of overlap between historical research and political dialectics, which, as we could see, is constantly growing through the labeling of controversial topics. And if it continues this way, we'll end up not being able to talk about anything. So either we let the uninformed mass dictate the ever-increasing number of topics which we are supposedly not allowed to talk about based on some form of sociological behavioralism, or we take a stand for freedom. I take the latter. Will you take it with me? So how many of these controversial videos of mine are about politics? 100? 30? None. Question: why does Metatron not divide his politically driven content from his main channel and make a dedicated channel, a second channel like Shadiversity did? An actual question that I was asked. Well, the reason why I don't do that is because I don't make political content. Now, Shad decided to do that, I absolutely respect that, because he did choose to speak specifically and openly, which is his right, of course, about his politics, his core beliefs, and he also has a sort of overall understanding and visualization of pop culture from that political standpoint. That's absolutely fine, therefore, that he decided to disconnect that from Shadiversity because it would not have been appropriate for that channel. But for me, I don't talk about politics. And apart from one video that I made once because I was asked to, specifically to let people know that I don't talk about politics, so I made a video about politics to tell people that I don't talk about politics, I will never say, oh, the left did this, the right did that, and Matt Walsh this, and this Democrat did that. All of my content, which has been accused of being politically driven, was always connected to history. Without a historical tether, I don't talk about it. Hence, this is all historical content, not political. And therefore, the simple fact that I've been told that I should have stayed clear from these controversial topics because they could offend people's sensitive mind or people could have an overall misunderstanding of who I am or what I stand for. Well, to those people I say first, I'm no coward. And second, I'm not interested in chasing an ever-changing societal positioning, because that will drive you mad. And most importantly, doesn't matter what people think, truth never changes. So the simple fact that people call defending real historical truth politics or political grifting is on them. The Metatron channel is a channel about seeking historically accurate information about the ancient past. It is also important to say that there is a very connection with this idea that I'm trying to push of open debate and the very past that I talk about on this channel, ancient Greece. In fact, it was the very base of the democratic society in Athens to have the ability to openly challenge positions. And it was considered, at least philosophically speaking, as the best way to seek or pursue the truth. So you could say that, so my positions, my ideas are not modern, they're connected to ancient freaking Greece. If truth is what you seek, then clearly you need to make sure that you don't just debunk lies or propaganda from one side of the political spectrum, if it is connected to politics when they try to change history, but that you try and attack every person on all sides, which is what I do. So it's actually kind of funny that sometimes people accuse me of just, for example, debunking left-wing propaganda and never talk about right-wing propaganda. And yet I made these videos, link in the description below, where I show that I do debunk both sides. I don't particularly care what kind of politics or religion or lack thereof the person who spreads inconsistent historical information has. The only thing they need to have to be debunked is to say something that is historically incorrect. And if you follow my Twitter, you know that I talk about both sides. And one thing that you can look forward to in the soon future is, in fact, a couple of videos that I have, some that will debunk something said by a left-winger, which was historically incorrect, and something said by a right-winger, which was historically incorrect. Look forward to that. Another thing that I'm told I should change are my thumbnails. Not gonna happen. The way my videos are structured is that oftentimes they have a question. The reason why I tend to use questions is because a question challenges, whereas a statement, in a way, spoils. A question arises curiosity. It beckons data and stimulates the curious mind. Still, if someone sees a video of mine where I ask, were the ancient Romans black or Nordic? What I noticed is that the latter doesn't usually take much attacks, but the first, the former, does have a certain amount of people, luckily it's a minority, that thinks, oh, he must be racist. Otherwise, why would he ask that question? And the absurdity of these people's mental framing goes all the way to a full-on strawman, as I see in the comments. Or, are you racist? Do you hate black people? Is that why you're asking this question? Strawman. On them. I'm very aware that people sometimes judge me because of my thumbnails or titles and consider me to be a bigot or a racist or a homophobe without even watching the content. Once again, that's on them. And to be honest, I'm glad that people like that don't click. Good riddance. I, however, very much respect those people that go through the thumbnail, click the video, watch it, and then in the comments disagree with me. Much respected. And also thank you to those who agree with me. With all that being said, as we begin 2024, I do commit myself to the pursuit of unbiased truth. I'll keep telling it how it is, and I won't let you down. And I do want to take this opportunity to thank all and every single one of you noble ones for your continuous, unwavering support. Thank you very much for watching, and remember, the Metatron has spread his wings once again. Still my heart, the moment I